So the plan of this talk is to make a sort of revision of Walton's account of fictionality by interpreting make-believe actually in a different way with respect to the way in which Kendall did, even if I take it that in point of fact, there are some similarities with what Walton says that might, in a sense, suggest that this might be the right way to go. So according to Walton, as we have already said, make-believe is conceived as an invitation or even a prescription to imagine. But if this is the case, many people have said, there is no chance for this to meet the mark of fictionality. But this does not depend on the fact that fiction involves both beliefs and imagination, as people have normally said against Walton. For in point of fact, one might suitably reconstruct the relevant kinds of fiction involving state as contextually fictional beliefs that are respectively matched and not matched by contextually real beliefs, and I will try to show in a minute what I mean by that. And so this is not a real problem, for we can reconstruct in some way what Walton is in mind there. So if we want to say that in point of fact, the fiction is grounded into a sort of specific form of imagination, then we have to revise our notion of imagination and do not appeal to what Walton is in mind by just leaving aside a normative conception of imagination, which is what Walton actually exploited, and develop a sort of meta-representational account of the imagination that is involved with fiction, so to make a revision at the cognitive level, not the normative one. So as to Walton's make-believe account, fiction consists in make-believing something, and as I said, make-believe is conceived normatively as an invitation or a prescription to imagine certain content, where in point of fact, such an imagination is bounded by facts concerning the real props that are exploited in the relevant game of make-believe. So that fictional facts depend on such real facts. Sentences that are fictionally true in a certain game of make-believe depend on the fact that other sentences on the very props, the real items that are involved in the game, are really true. But as we have already seen, both Derek and Stacy Friend actually have risen some criticism against this idea, for the idea is that Walton is involved with a certain notion of imagination, which is not, sorry, of fiction, which is not exactly the very same notion that we should target in order to find the real criterion for fictionality. And as Stacy nicely puts it, the notion that Walton mobilizes may be called world fiction, and world fiction is not fiction. Why world fiction is not fiction? So the account that Walton provides cannot be the right one, for it's simply addressed to something that is not a real phenomenon that we want to understand. For on the one hand, world fiction it is too broader than fiction, for also non-fictional works invite their readers to imagine something that is what is for someone to live in different places or times or to have different experiences and so on and so forth. So even non-fictional work might prompt exactly the very same sort of imagination. And these are the examples that Stacy provides. Take the description of Disraeli's house in Simon Sharma's History of Britain, which is to be taken as a sort of paradigmatic history text in which the reader is invited to imagine various things. And this might happen even with the philosophical works that normally at least are not taken as work of fiction. And it is also too narrower than that notion, for many fictional narratives, in point of fact, and historical novels are the paradigmatic cases that, but they are not the only ones, invite us not only to make believe something, but also to believe what they tell, in order for one to understand that something is an historical novel. One has to understand that in point of fact what is described in the novel is something that must be believed as well as made believe. So this cannot be the right way of putting things. But the real problem, I just skip here the reference to what Stacy says here, is that Do we draw beliefs from fiction along with surrounding them with the imaginations, or do we just mobilize make-beliefs? So here we have to revise, I guess, our notion of make-believe by following in some way whether Walton's conception is really forced to be a normative account of make-believe. This is an imagination, is an invitation or a prescription to imagine. For in point of fact, there are two different forms of make-believe that one may appeal to in order to differently account, still as I said, in a sort of very broad Waltonian sense, for fiction as make-believe. The first one has to do with the fact that we have to take make-believe in one sense, not as a form of imagination, but as a genuine belief that simply arises in a context that is different from the real one. So make-believe, make in make-believe sounds as a modifier that indicates that we have to locate a belief that is the content of the relevant state, not in the real context, but in a different context that has to do with fiction. And secondly, as we will see, in order to understand why, in point of fact, fiction involves a spatial form of imagination, we have to appeal to this sort of metacognitive level, in a sense very close to what Anna had in mind before, that is, there is a different sense of make-believe, according to which make-believe is a complex meta-representational state that presupposes different single representational states of belief and make-believe taken as this form of contextual modification of beliefs by being about them. So, the real imagination that counts is this sort of meta-representational state that is about both a belief that arises in the real context and a make-believe, which is a belief that arises in a non-real, actually in a fictional context. So this is the whole plan of the story. In order to get to proceed in this direction, let me start by what Walton says about fear, and in particular what I want to call make-fear. For, as you know, in a later paper by Ken, Spelunking Simulation and Slime, if I remember correctly the title, Walton is trying to revise what was taken to be his previous account of make-believe fear, in that in the book, in the Mimesis book of 1990, he seemed that he appealed to this sort of state, as if it were a sort of sui generis state, different from fear, as being a sort of what he labeled there a quasi-fear, that in a way resembles a lot of state of emotions, such as fear, for it might have the same sort of physiological reaction, it might involve the same sort of physiological reactions, and maybe it also shares the same phenomenology, but in point of fact, it's not the right emotion. So this is what Walton appeared to say in the book, but he has revised this appearance by saying later that, in point of fact, this was not what he meant by appealing to fear as something that arises also in make-believe context. For he said, well, look, the kind of emotion that really arises when we have to do with fiction is a genuine case of fear. It's simply that it arises in a limited scope, so to speak, in the context of the make-believe game. So when we are, for instance, attending the famous movie concerning the green slime, we really fear, so to speak, the slime that is, in a way, approaching us. But we are simply fearing, we are afraid of the slime, simply in the scope of the make-believe context. So it's not that it is another sort of state that is involved there, but it is precisely the very same state that arises and, so to speak, lives only within the scope of that very context, right? So if this is the case, then one in such a context, one entertains a genuine emotion of fear that is attached to something that exists in the world of the context, even if it does not exist after it. For the green slime, for instance, is a protagonist of the game, but of course it's an imaginary item that does not belong to, let's say, to our real inventory of what there is, right? So we might say that this emotion, fear in a make-believe context might be labeled as a make fear, where make works as this sort of modification. It is a modification of fear, but just not in the in the sense that Searle appealed to when he said in his 1975 paper that, for instance, in fiction, we appeal to sort of mock assertions or make-believe assertions as modified assertions in the sense that they are speech acts that in point of fact do not follow the very same rules as the genuine speech acts actually follow. Not in that sense, not in a normative sense, but just modification in the contextual sense. It is a fear, it is a genuine state of emotion that simply arises or exists in a different scope, which is individuated in terms of the different context. But if this is the case as far as fear is concerned, we can generalize Walton's move as to any other sort of state and mental state and say that in fiction, in point of fact, we are surrounded by the very same kinds of mental states that simply arise in the particular context. This might be the case also, for instance, of a way of meaning what a make desire is. Again, one might say that a make desire is not a sui generis mental state, but simply a desire that we entertain as far as we are involved in the context of the make-believe game. For instance, in the case that Anna was pointing, even though Anna was speaking about a daydreaming case, but in that very in the context of that daydreaming, if we might take that as a sort of genuine fictional context, I might desire to be the Duchess of Cambridge, just within that very scope of the game. And if this is the case, so we don't have to consider make desire, for instance, in the way that Greg Curry actually does. It's not I desire in the sense that Greg pointed out, precisely because it is not a sui generis mental state, it's not a sort of counterpart of a real desire, so it's a sort of state that in some sense resembles the desire that we normally entertain, but it's simply a desire that is entertained in a make-believe context. And if this is the case, we can apply this move also as far as make-beliefs are concerned, that is, what is primarily make-believe, what is the sort of state that the sort of more relevant state that is involved as far as fiction is concerned. It's make-believe, precisely in this very sense, that it is a genuine belief that is simply entertained in the very context of a certain make-believe game, and it turns out to be a modification of belief just in this very weak sense, if you like. So if one makes fear of a green slime, then one also makes believe that it is dangerous in the sense that in the relevant context of make-believe, one both has the fear about the slime and the belief that the slime is dangerous. And if one makes a desire an attractive lady, then one also makes believe that she is charming in the sense that in the relevant context of make-believe, one both has that desire and that very belief. And in this way, make-believe might be taken as an important element in fiction, for fiction involves all such kinds of make states, and in particular make-believe if it is taken in the way that I have in particular indicated. So make-believe is in particular an important element of fiction. Who takes part in a make-believe game typically has at least some make-believes in this very sense. So it is not an imagination that one is invited to, but it is a genuine mental state of belief that is simply entertained in a make-believe context. In some sense, Greg was mimicking this idea when he said that, in point of fact, the sort of imagination that we entertain as far as fiction is concerned is an I belief. But again, by I belief, Greg means sort of sui generis mental state, which is not what I mean here. The sort of belief that we entertain in the scope of a make-believe game is precisely the very same sort of mental state that we, once we step out of pretense, we can also entertain in the real world. So what happens here is that typically such a make-believe is not matched by a real belief, that is, by a belief that arises in a real context. This is what makes one erroneously speak of imagination in this context. in this context, right? One says, well, make believe, well, fiction involves imagination, not belief. But no, this is not the case in my reconstruction. This fiction involves beliefs, but it is, at least normally, a sort of belief that just arises in the scope of make-believe, and it is not matched by a corresponding belief that arises in the real context. This in the typical case, but there are of course other cases, and historical novels are prototypical examples of that, in which there is such a matching, right? That is, in point of fact, as far as historical novels are concerned, one entertains a certain belief both within the make-believe context, the fictional context, and outside of that context, in the real world. So it's one as simply as, just by sheer chance, as one might say, the very same state that is entertained in both contexts. Whereas normally, there is just one state of belief that is entertained within the scope of make-believe. So, in a sense, this justifies what Gibson has said against Stacy, that one cannot both believe that P and make believe that P if one has fixed a certain evaluation attitude. Suffices that one takes that such an attitude is an expression of the context one is involved in. It is one believes that P in a real context, and one also makes believe that P in the sense that one believes that P, but in a make-believe context. And this is what historical novels in point of fact show. This is a particular case. In the other cases, which is more frequent, one simply entertains a make-believe, that is a belief in a make-believe context, which is simply not matched by a real belief, that is a belief that arises in a real context. Let me just provide you some examples. Let us consider the following. My students already know these examples, for I am always using this example. Okay, so I am trying to popularize Alessandro Manzoni out of the boundaries of Italy now. Manzoni will become very famous everywhere in the world. I am always relying on this sort of example. So Alessandro Manzoni was supposed to write, for those who do not know who Alessandro Manzoni was, he was a sort of follower of Walter Scott. And so he imitated Walter Scott when Scott wrote Ivano, and Manzoni wrote The Betrothed, I Promessi Sposi. And this is the very beginning, right, of this work, in which there is a description of a certain area in northwest Lombardy that concerns Lake Como and what actually flows out of that, of a particular branch of that very lake. So that branch of the Lake Como, blah, 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 assumes the flow and the appearance of a river. And another example might be instead at the beginning of Ulysses, in which Joyce is talking about a certain Buck Mulligan that came from the stairhead bearing a bowl of lather on which a mirror razor lay crossed, and so on and so on. In which sense, as far as our mental states are concerned, do these examples differ? Just in this very sense, that is, that one is both a fictional and a real truth, depending on the way in which the sentence is uttered, either in the fictional context, in the belief context, or in a non-fictional context, in a real context. So it is a fictional truth in the make-believe world of the betrothed, but it is also a real truth in the real world. And if this is the case, then one more may both believe and make-believe the very same content, which might be taken to be, in a Rassilian sense, a singular one that is associated to that sentence. Simply one believes this very content once in the fictional context that is generated via Manzoni's writing, and in a real context in which maybe simply the very same text is taken as being simply an historical text that describes that part of geography. So Manzoni, by the way, was unlike Scott. Manzoni was really reliable, so you can really use the Betrothed as a sort of guide if you want to navigate in Lombardy. Okay. So one believes the content when one is involved in a real context. So when one is reading the text as an historical work, not as a fictional one, and one makes believe it, that is, one believes it when one is involved in the make-believe context of the Betrothed. This when reading Manzoni's text as a fictional work and not an historical one. This is what happens in this particular case, which is not the usual case, let's say it's a limiting case. Whereas as far as the Ulysses sentence is concerned, then we have that beginning of that story is just a fictional truth. For in point of fact, it's just a fictional truth in the make-believe world of the of the Ulysses, for one makes believe the singular content that is associated to that sentence in a make-believe context. But what happens in this very case is that one does not believe that very content in a real context, for simply, since there is in this case a name that is really empty, such as Buck Mulligan, right, then there is nothing that can be believed in the real context. So one makes believe it, that is, one believes the singular content when one is involved with the make-believe context of Ulysses, but once you step out of that make-believe context, one does not believe it when one is involved in a real context, for simply there is nothing to believe there. The name in question is empty. Or, if you don't want to adhere to a sort of Kripkean or direct reference theory of the semantics of proper names, and you simply want to espouse a Russian theory of proper names, according to which proper names are disguised definite descriptions, then one might still say, well, in the real context, there is a different content, which is not a singular one. It's just a general one, a descriptive content that is anyway different from the singular content that was mobilized as far as the fictional context was concerned. Let me just skip these slides about to stop. So, okay, this might be a sort of nice account, that is, no imagination as a sort of mental state is involved as far as fiction is concerned. Simply, there is what fiction primarily mobilizes is just belief, but belief that it is to be taken as scoped within the context of the make-believe game of the fictional situation. But of course, this is just a sort of sloppy way of putting things. Can we in some way specify what we mean by that? What does entertaining a make state, that is a mental state either of belief, of desire, or fear in a context of make-believe actually amounts to? And here, if we don't provide this clarification, well, the idea that a make state is just a modification of the corresponding mental state in the sense of a state that is entertained in a context doesn't mean very much. So we can provide a sort of clarification as to that. If we appeal to what I call minimal contextualism, that is, we have to rely on Kaplan's theory of context, and in particular a narrow context, in order to more precisely explain what we mean by appealing to either fictional contexts or real context. What is a context of make-believe? It's a narrow context in the strict Kaplanian sense, that it is a set theoretical entity that is made by just a limited number of parameters, at least four, that is an agent, a place, a time, and a world. And the make-believe context, the main difference that arises as far as the make-believe context and a non-make-believe context, a real context is concerned, is simply that the world parameter shifts. So in the context of make-believe, the context is qualified by the fact that the world parameter is saturated by a world of make-believe. The world, whatever it metaphysically amounts to, in which the things that are narrated in a film, in a novel, and so on, unfold the way in which they are narrated. And the real context, on the other hand, is a context whose world parameter is saturated by the real world. Or you can just expand the idea and say that, for instance, you can apply the idea also to, say, possible context, for instance. And this is a form of, a minimal form of contextualism, for it just allows to assign truth conditions to sentences as they are paired to this sort of a minimal context. Just as we normally do as far as indexical sentences are concerned, we are just applying the very same move that we normally apply when we have to assign a truth condition meaning, say, to the sentence, I am Italian, for instance, so that we appeal to a narrow context of the same kind. So in this way, a world of make-believe is just a semantical posit, This forget the metaphysical problem, what a make-believe world really amounts to. It is a possible world, an impossible world, a set of possible worlds. Doesn't matter. It simply works as this parameter that works in order for the sentence when it is uttered with respect to that particular context to have a truth conditional meaning. So if this is the case, a narrow context allows sentences first to get certain truth conditions. These, on the one end, make-believe truth conditions, and on the other end, the real truth conditions. And second, to be evaluated with respect to the relevant circumstances. These make-believe circumstances or world will yield make-believe truths or falsehoods, whereas real circumstances that appear that belong to the real world will yield the real truth or falsehood, and so on. So what happens here is that in non-historical novels, sentences that are paired with a make-believe context will typically get truth conditions that differ from what they get when they are paired with a real context. Whereas in historical novels, sentences that are paired with a make-believe context will typically get exactly the very same truth conditions as those that they get when they are paired with a real context. So again, let me provide you some examples. If we take the trivial sentence, Holmes is a detective, and we consider the sentence as being make-believably true, that is, it is true when it is uttered in a particular context of make-believe, insofar as the name in that very context there refers to an individual that is a detective in that very world, but the sentence cannot have the same content once we just step out of the make-believe context and we pair the sentence with a real context, and then in that case the sentence is not true for Holmes, the name Holmes in the real context refers to nothing. Whereas if we take a case of a sentence that we might find in War and Peace, such as Napoleon invaded Russia, then the situation is different, for the sentence is both really and make-believe is true, insofar as the name, both in the real and the make-believe context, refers to an individual that invaded Russia, both in the real world and in the world of Tolstoy's tale. So the sentences, just by chance, if you like, assigned exactly the very same truth conditions, both in this particular case, both in the fictional and in the non-fictional context. And this context also allows the relevant mental states to be satisfied or unsatisfied in the world of the context. Then we can get that a make-believe concerning what is narrated in a non-historical tale typically has truth conditions that are satisfied in the world of the make-believe context, while its corresponding belief has truth conditions, if there are any, that are not satisfied in the real world. That is, in this very case, we have a make-believe that Holmes is a detective, but we don't exactly know whether we have a similar real belief to the effect that, who knows, is a detective, simply because in the real context the name Holmes lacks a reference. Then it depends on your own theory whether there is a singular, there is a sort of partial content for the sentence because the name lacks a reference, or you want to appeal to a Russellian theory of names and then say that in that context the belief that arises in that context has a sort of descriptive content, right? Whereas in the case of an historical tale, one and the same thing, which is both a make-believe concerning what is narrated in a historical tale and a belief concerning the same thing but holding in the real world, typically has truth conditions that are satisfied both in the world of the make-believe context and in the real world, as in the case of the belief, which is also make-believe, that Napoleon invaded Russia. So now, formally at least, everything works. I have precisified what I mean by fictional context and real context just by appealing to Kaplan's theory. But that is just a trick, of course, for this is just gives you a sort of formal reconstruction and formal account to say that something is a belief insofar as it is linked with a certain real context, that it is a make-believe insofar as it is linked to a certain make-believe context. But then the question arises again, that is, what is, in a way, what is that makes a context of make-believe a context of make-believe, in an interesting sense, for otherwise we have just used the technicalities, so to speak. We might have said exactly the very same story instead of talking about make-believe context, I would have spoken of a possible context, for instance. Context that link a sentence with the way in which it is used in a possible world that is different from ours, right? So we want an account that simultaneously explains why that context and this world are respectively a make-believe context and the make-believe world, and this bios explains what it means to entertain a make-believe that is a belief in a make-believe context, right? So we have to appeal to, in Perry's sense, if you like, to something that has to do with something that is involved at the pre-semantic level. It is, how can we manage to perform the shift between what we call a real context and a make-believe context? Precisely because in the case of a make-believe context, what we are appealing to is a complex meta-representational state that is the pragmatic factor that, so to speak, explains why we can provide the shift. And it is a meta-representational state, for it concerns both representations that are addressed to the real world and representations that are addressed to the make-believe world. So what is now this sort of meta-representational state, which makes the substantive role in the game? So the state presupposes first a representation that is addressed to the real world, typically a belief, then a representation that concerns the imaginary world, if you like, and this is typically a make-believe. And third, and more interesting, it is a meta-representational state to the effect that the first representation is disconnected from the second representation, for it is entertained in a different representational model. So the idea is that you have two models, two representational models, one which is addressed to the real world, another one which is addressed to the unreal world, plus a meta-representational state that says that one representation that is put into the first model is not the same as the representation that is put in the other model, right? And one needs this meta-representation in order to explain why representing the make-believe world is behaviorally ineffective, as people have said. That is, it's not just the fact that you are representing something as to an imaginary world that explains why you are not behaving, as Anna was magnificently explaining to you before, that explains why you do not perform any sort of behavior. In order for behavior to be blocked, you need this meta-representational state, the sort of cognitive element. So if we get, for instance, to the case of the green slide, why is this taken as a sort of representation that has to do with make-believe? For in this very case, one entertains a sort of complex representational triad. For on the one hand, one is just facing a screen. This is the real situation. And so one refers to a screen in the representational box that has to do with the real world by saying this is a representational, this is a cinema screen, and then by one believes that this is a cinema screen. But one also entertains the representation, this is a green line that is addressed to a non-real world, and then one believes in this sense, in this contextual sense, that this is a green line. But then one also has to entertain the meta representation that says that the first representation and the second representation are separated as far as their representational model is concerned. And this is needed in order to explain why you do not get out of the cinema in panic when you have seen the sort of tremendous scenes. And just to show you a sort of anecdote that probably is not true at all, what was lacking in the Lumière case at the very beginning of the cinema representation was precisely the third meta-representational state. This is why people escaped from the cinema. For doesn't matter whether the story is true or not, but people in that case still entertained the representation addressed to the real world, this is a cinema screen. They also entertained the representation, this is a locomotive addressed to an imaginary world, but they did not entertain the meta-representation that the first representation and the second representation were actually put in different boxes. And this is why they got out of the cinema in panic. So in this sense, I claim we can again appeal to the Walton's project. Remember, the Walton's project was, if we manage to find a certain sort of imagination that is relevant just for fiction, we can say that that sort of imagination is both a necessary and sufficient condition for fiction. But my idea is simply that Walton moved in the wrong direction by looking for something that was normatively imbued as an invitation to imagine something. Whereas here, I take that this sort of make-believe that I'm appealing to is just a cognitive, metacognitive, to better say, state that makes the whole thing. So make-believe in its sense is necessary for fiction. For in order for fiction to arise, one must entertain this form of meta-representation. And in point of fact, without that form, what we will simply have is a sort of dissociated way of representing that possibly is behaviorally confusing, as just in the Lumière case, but the Lumière case is not the only case. There are many cases that are shown by the psychological literature that precisely show that in point of fact that the representation that you entertain in the imaginative model, as Anna was saying before, have a sort of behavioral effect, but the sort of behavioral effect that they have, precisely because you are missing this sort of third meta-representation state, is confused, right? This might happen as far as the Cotard illusion is concerned. People that are affected by this illusion, first they believe that they are alive in the so-called reality representational model. They also believe that they are dead in the other model, in the imagination model. But they live with this dissociation, possibly exhibiting a sort of incoherent form of behavior. This also happens in the so-called weak forms of the Capgras syndrome. Are exactly, they work precisely in the very same way. In this case, if they are real cases, there's always a sort of feeling that these sort of cases are a bit tricky, but let me forget about that, that somebody is just taking a sort of excuse for getting free of his own wife. But let me forget about this sort of a side consideration. Okay. So people living with their wives, even if they go on living with their wives, even if they take them as impostors. And so again, what happens here is that first, they believe this is an impostor in the imagination model and complain about that with their friends. So they have a sort of behavioral effect of this representation that is entertained in the imaginary model. But they do not call the police, for they still behave friendly with the purported impostor, so to speak. Why? For they also believe this is my wife in the reality model. So they have this sort of dissociated behavior just because they apply to these different representations without being aware of the fact that two representations are separated as far as the representational model are concerned. And so my idea is also that make-believe in this sense is also sufficient for fiction. For entertaining the above form of meta representation is enough in order for fiction to arise. For instance, I take it that if we go back to the problematic case of myths, when myths become fiction or reveal, if you like, to be fiction, perhaps it's better. For a long while, a myth is not taken to be fictional at all. So, for instance, people that wrote or read the Greek mythology for a long while, in point of fact, took that mythology to describe real supernatural things. They really believed that some gods actually lived at the very top of Mount Olympus, that Zeus was a sort of nasty guy, for he had a sort of sexual improper behavior, and so on and so forth. Okay, but at a certain point, myths reveal to be fictional. When do they reveal that? For when they are accompanied by this form of meta-representation. It is once you realize that, in point of fact, there is also this form of meta-representation that is involved, then you can separate, even in the case of myth, a representation that simply concerns, say, what you are saying or what you are writing, so the very physical items, patches of ink and so on and so forth that are actually applied on a sheet of paper. And then there is the imaginary representation, this is used, for instance, and that there must be, in order for this to become a myth in our senses, sort of another fictional sort of literature, another fictional piece of literature. You also have to have this sort of meta-representational state to the effect that the first representation and the second representation are separated, they are not in the same representational box. And something that displays such a form of meta-representation becomes fictional, so it is a sufficient condition, as the following two examples, I guess, show. So, for instance, consider the famous case of optical illusions, right? The famous case of the Müller-Lie illusion. Normally, this is not fiction. That's right. Why it is not fictional? For it does not involve the right kind of meta-representation. It might become fictional once the sort of the perception of this very shape is accompanied also by the relevant meta-representational state. So if you simply know that this representation is false, okay, the representation that tells you that the two segments have exactly the very same length, well, you might have a sort of meta-representation, but it's not the right meta-representation. It's simply a meta-representation that says that such a representation, qua representation of the actual world, is inaccurate, right? So when you are, in a way, you are no longer suffering from delusion. Your perceptual mechanism still conveys to you exactly the very same content, but somebody might tell you, well, look, don't believe that, right? Your perception is not to be taken as being reliable. So you might have this sort of meta-representation that involves your very perception, in your very illusory perception, to the effect that the two segments have exactly the same length. This is not fiction, okay? When it might become fictional, this sort of representation? When one exactly entertains this sort of a complex meta-representational story, that is, one first entertains a representation in the reality model that says that these lines have the same length, and then you get another representation in an imaginary model that says that these lines do not have the same length, and plus you have to be aware that such representations are disconnected. And another example points exactly to the same direction, to the famous Magritte case. Why this can be taken as a sort of example of a fictional painting? Well, for again, here you have this sort of a complex, from the cognitive point of view, situation. First, you in the reality model, in the reality representational model, you represent something that concerns the image itself, that is the very same canvas that you are facing, right? And this is not a pipe, right? You are not deceived at all. You realize that the sort of the physical item that you are facing is not a pipe, is a sheet of paper or whatever it is, made of jute or whatever. But then one also represents in an imaginary model that concerns what is presented by the image. This is a pipe. And then what makes it the case that it becomes a sort of piece of fiction is that one is aware of such a representational difference. It is one represents the fact that the two representations are to be put in different representational models. So, just to before concluding, how much Waltonian is this account? As I told you at the very beginning, I wanted to say, well, the original idea by Walton is right. This you cannot just appeal to imagination in order to capture what makes something to be fiction. You have to, as Walton originally said in his 1973 paper, you have to appeal to a special form of imagination that Walton wanted to cash out in normative terms, right? That sort of specific form of imagination is not a free floating form of imagination. It's a bounded and constrained form of imagination. For in point of fact, you cannot, as far as fiction is concerned, you cannot imagine whatever you like, right? You have to imagine what in some sense depends on the features that real props actually possess. And once you appeal to certain principles of generation that tells you that those props have to count as certain imaginary characters, for instance, then you have the normative element that allows you to imagine not only in a bounded way, but also in a correct way what you have to imagine in a certain particular game. So, for instance, if I have a game, a make-believe game that is involved with these three physical items, and I take those items as props, they count my principle of generation that says that those physical items have to count as pieces of cakes, then it is true in the game that the cake in the middle is smaller than the other two cakes, just in virtue of the fact that this very watch, the real thing that works as a prop, is smaller than both the glass and the bottle, right? And so this is, in virtue of the fact that this is really the case, then you can get what is fictionally the case in Walton's account, that becomes, in virtue of the principle of generation, the correct way of playing the game. Okay, this was the way in which Walton wanted to develop his own account. And Derek and Stacy have, to me at least, correctly shown that this is neither necessary nor sufficient. It's not enough. So we have to again look for the right sort of make-believe, but it's not the one that Walton has in mind. But nevertheless, it has some connection to this. In making fiction, depending on a meta-representational mental state, this account of fiction, this is the way in which I part company with Walton, is a mere cognitive account that loses any reference to normativity. For here is just a cognitive level that is involved. In that, indeed, I claim that when little children learn to be involved in pretense plays or in make-believe games, they just not to follow any rule whatsoever, that they just have to endorse the relevant sort of meta-representation. So it's a mere cognitive account that loses any reference to normativity that, as I said before, plays a sort of substantive role in Walton's account. For in the present account, normativity comes into the fore, is if ever, just later. It is when one must assess whether a certain make-believe game is correct or not. That is, when it is played in conformity with how it was played by its originator, which she was endowed with the relevant representation. Remember that in Walton's account, it's just the author does not make believe. It's simply the audience that makes believe something. The audio is just out of the picture in some sense or other. Precisely because the author is simply making this sort of normative invitation to the audience to make believe or to imagine something in a certain way. Whereas here in this account, the very originator of the game has to be involved with make-believe, if make-believe is reconstructed the way in which I wanted to appeal to. But nevertheless, I think that there is some sort, since as you probably know, I'm rather syncretistic, so I'm Catholic. So I want to say that there is merit and drawbacks in any sort of philosophy, so I want to retrieve a bit any sort of crazy philosophy that is possibly around. So there is a sense according to which I want still to stick a bit of Waltonian, and it is Waltonian not only because it appears to make beliefs contextualized beliefs, that I think is a sort of legitimate move once you appeal to the fact that in Walton's account, make fear is precisely this sort of thing, is fear in the context of fiction. But this cannot be the whole story, the end of the story, for if we simply appeal to contextualized beliefs, we do not get fiction, right? It's not enough. We need something more, okay? But nevertheless, this appeal to context may make my suggestion being a bit Waltonian. And also because, by appealing to belief context, my account explains in which sense something is a fictional falsehood or a fictional truth, for it is something having truth conditions that are not satisfied or satisfied in the make-believe world of the context. So I take it that the idea of Walton of appealing to make-believe in his sense can be cashed out in the minimally contextualist sense that I was providing to you before. It seems that this cannot be the end of the story, for just appealing to different contexts does not explain to you why the relevant context is a make-believe context. You might do exactly the very same game as far as the dreams were concerned. You might say that in dreams, oneiric contexts are mobilized, and that oneiric contexts are different from real context, precisely because, again, the world parameter shifts. In oneiric context, the world parameter is saturated by the world of the dream, okay, which is not the real world, it's the world that is the way in which things unfold in that very situation. But dream is not fiction, so we need something more. Okay, thank you very much.